Hi everyone, I am Dr. Sunita Patil from Department of Pathology, D.Y. Patil Medical College, Kolhapur. Here I am going to present a lecture on flow cytometry.
This is a flow cytometer. We'll go through details of flow cytometry under following headings. That is introduction, history, principle of flow cytometer, components, data analysis, flow cytometer protocol, diagnostic applications, summary, and at the end references. Here is the introduction. Flow is motion. Cyto are cells. Metry is to measure. It is the measuring properties of a cell while in fluid stream. So flow cytometry is quickly expanding technology. It is popular since mid 80s and the popularity is in increasing mode. It is though expensive and sophisticated technology, but the use is increasing from research to clinical laboratories. If you go by the history, in 1950, Casperson first demonstrated that nucleic acid content and protein in unstained cell could be quantified by measuring absorption of light in ultraviolet and visible spectrum. Later in 1965, Kamensky developed multi-parameter flow cytometer. And later, that is in 1968, Wolfgang of German University, he developed first fluorescence based flow cytometer. Originally it was called as pulse cytometry, but officially the name has changed to flow cytometry in 1978 in a conference held in Florida. Flow cytometry is a technology that simultaneously measures and then analyzes numerous cell properties as a cell move in a single file in a fluid column and interrupt a beam of laser light. It helps in quantitative and qualitative analysis. The properties measured by flow cytometry is relative size of the cells, relative granularity of the cells, and relative fluorescence intensity as well. Coming to the principle, flow cytometry is an optical to electronic coupling system that records how a cell scatters incident laser light and emits fluorescence. This process is performed at a rate of thousands of cells per second. The components of the flow cytometer are as under: fluidics. Next comes the optics. It consists of optical filters and optical detectors and electronics. This consists of amplification system and computer software. This is an overview of the instrument consisting of lasers, which are part of the optics, filters and detectors. These form parts of the optics, and fluidic system where the fluid sheet and you'll get the core sample stream. And the last one is the electronics, comprised of amplifiers and computer software and analyzers. The fluidics, they introduce and focus cells for analysis, whereas optics, they generate and collect the light signals. These light signals are converted to electronic signals for computer analysis by electronics. Now we'll deal with each component in detail. The first one being the fluidics. So fluidics transports cell in a fluid stream to laser beam for interrogation. So this is the sample stream consisting of monodispersed cell suspension that flow in a single cell. And this is the sheet fluid. It is an isotonic fluid under pressure in a tubing that delivers to the flow cell. The cells flow in a single file in the sample core stream, and at some point the cells are interrogated by the laser. The particles or the cells in the sample stream are randomly distributed in three-dimensional space, and these are ordered into a stream of single particles, as there is always higher pressure of the sample fluid as compared to the sheet fluid. As the sheet fluid and the sample streams are maintained at different pressure levels, there occurs no mixing up of sheet fluid and the sample stream, and the resultant is the laminar flow of the cells in the sample core stream. Hydrodynamic focusing results in introduction of large volumes into small volume, and the hydrodynamic pressure of sheet fluid and the sample stream are maintained such that the cells are focused along an axis, and the sample stream becomes compressed to roughly one cell in diameter. Interrogation point is the heart of the system where the laser and the sample intersect. The optics collect the resulting scatter and the fluorescence. Pressure difference between the sample and the sheet fluid controls flow rate of the sample volume. Low sample pressure, it leads to greater accuracy but takes longer time. Whereas high sample pressure, it is less accurate and it is much faster. Next, coming to optics, it consists of filters, detectors and the laser. For laser, visible light wavelength spectrum is used, ranging from 380 nanometers to 740 nanometers. Optics, these are of two types, excitation optics and collection optics. Excitation optics is nothing but the laser, whereas collection optics, it consists of lenses and optical filters. So laser is the high intensity beam of monochromatic light with uniform wavelength. It is quite expensive, but multiple lasers are used in flow cytometers to analyze cells. Most commonly used laser is argon ion laser that emits light at 488 nanometer. Sensitivity and resolution depends on shape and intensity of the laser beam. Due to laser light reflecting and refracting off the cells without alteration of the wavelength, so reflections and refractions of the cells, it can be of two types, that is forward scatter and side scatter. So forward scatter, it is the light scattered in the forward direction along the axis of a beam, that is 1 to 10 degrees. It is proportional to the size of the cell, refractive index of the cells and absorptive properties of the cells. Larger cells scatter more light than the smaller cells. Light is quantified by a detector that converts intensity into voltage. There is an obscuration bar which prevents any of the intense laser light from reaching the detector. The magnitude of the voltage pulse recorded for each cell is proportional to the cell size. Smaller the cell size, smaller is the voltage pulse. Larger the cell size, larger is the voltage pulse. Side scatter, it is the light reflected from the internal structures of the cell. It correlates with the granularity of the cells. The signals collected by the side scatter detector located at 90 degrees from the laser path. This is the detector which is placed at the 90 degree, and this is the cell. Here is the laser beam. So why forward scatter and side scatter? Study of forward scatter and side scatter allows us to know the differentiation of different types of the cell. For example, granulocyte, it will have more side scatter as well as the forward scatter. As it is the largest cell, it will have a more forward scatter, and because of its granularity, it will have more side scatter than compared to the lymphocyte, which is being smaller and lacks granules. Fluorescence. Fluorochrome is absorb light over a range of wavelength and emit light at a longer wavelength. Absorption of light results in electron to be raised to a higher energy level. An excited electron, it quickly decays to its ground state, emitting excess energy as photon of light. And this transition energy is termed as fluorescence. So this is the electron at a ground state. When excited, it is pushed to the higher level and instantly it decays, resulting in emission of the energy and comes back to the ground state. This emission of energy is fluorescence, resulting in the formation of absorption wave and the emission wave. So these are the absorption and emission spectrum. Fluorochromes are used for conjugation with monoclonal antibodies or to bind to a DNA or RNA material. These are some of the fluorochromes which emit the wavelength in the visible light spectra. These are fluorescein, isothiocyanate, phycoerythrin, peritinine, chlorophyll alpha protein, Texas red, allophycosinin. Tandem fluorochromes, two fluorochromes covalently conjugated. So these allow us use of one argon ion laser. So energy from one fluorochrome is transferred to second fluorochrome, which cannot be directly excited at 488 nanometer. This second fluorochrome in turn emits fluorescent light at a wavelength higher than that of first one. So this eliminates need of dual lasers. So spectral characteristics of nucleic acid dyes are as under. Some of the nucleic acid dye are propidium iodide, ethidium bromide, acridine orange. And these are the excitation and emission characteristics. Optical filters. So these direct specified wavelength of light to designated optical detectors. Side scatter and fluorescent light collected together and then separated in order to detect them independently. Optical filters are further separated as absorption filters and interference filters. Absorption filters are made up of colored glass, and these absorb unwanted light and pass the light with desired wavelength. As a result of light absorption, these filters produce fluorescence, especially after light absorption of short wavelengths. Whereas interference filters, these attenuate or reflect unwanted light, accomplished by depositing specific series of metals and dielectrics onto substrate. These can be of long pass, short pass, band pass, and dichroic mirror. So long paths, these allow light above a cutoff wavelength. Short paths, these permit light below a cutoff wavelength. And band paths, these transmit light within a specified narrow range of wavelength. And dichroic mirror, these reflect a specific range of light and pass all others. Then comes the optical detectors. So these are again of two types, photoiodides and photomultiplier tubes. Photoiodides, these are used for strong signals, that is for forward scatter, whereas photomultipliers, these are used for detection of side scatters and small amounts of fluorescence. These are more sensitive compared to photoiodides. Bandpass filters, in front of them, they allow a specific bandwidth of light. What happens in a photomultiplier tube? So sensors, they convert photons to electrical impulse, which is proportional to the number of photons received. And it is proportional to the number of fluorochromes bond to a cell. Why used for fluorescence? Because fluorescent emissions are of low intensity. What is the mechanism? The mechanism is there occurs interaction of photons with photocathode, which produces photoelectrons. These photoelectrons are accelerated onto surface of a diode through a voltage potential, successively release enough electrons to generate an electric impulse. So these are the light photons which are directed on photocathode. This in turn produces photoelectrons which are directed or accelerated on diodes, and in turn they generate electrical voltage. Then comes the electronics. So how a voltage pulse from the PMT is generated? When the cell just touches the laser, there occurs a impulse voltage, and when it crosses the laser, it will be, the peak will be shown, and when it leaves, it drops down to the baseline. That's how a pulse is created. So once these electric pulses are generated, these are weak and should be amplified either linearly or logarithmically. Linear amplification, it presents differences in fluorochrome concentration between the cells, whereas logarithmic amplification, it reveals cell population that vary widely in their characteristics, example cell surface markers. In linear amplification, output signal is directly proportional to the input signal, whereas in logarithmic amplification, output is directly proportional to the logarithm of input signal. So linear amplification, it helps in quantitation of fluorescence of DNA, RNA and light scatter of cell size and granularity, whereas logarithmic amplification is used for immunophenotyping. Next comes the computer system. So it is used for data collection and display and analysis. Flow cytometric data stored according to the flow cytometry standard format. It is developed by Society of Analytical Cytology. Data storage file includes description of sample acquired, instruments on which data was collected, data set, results of data analysis. Acquisition of data. So the cells examined will be, it ranges from 5000 to 20,000 cells. Digitized data is stored either as histogram or list mode. More widely used is the list mode method of data collection. Various parameters like scatter, fluorescence are sorted as a list, or sorry, are stored as a list. Software then allows data to be reanalyzed and presented as histograms. This reprocessing of data is helpful, especially in complex specimen with heterogeneous cell population. Data display. Once a data file has been saved, the data can be displayed in a number of different plots. Like it can be displayed as histograms or 2D plots, that is scattergrams, density plot, contour plot, or by 3D plots. Histogram is a single parameter plot, display a single set of values, example DNA content in a population of cell. X-axis, it shows intensity of the detected signal. Y-axis measures the number of events, that is the cells counted. Dot plot, that is bivariate display or scattergram or bitmap. It plots one dot or point on the display for each cell which passes through the instrument. So each dot, it represents single cell. So this is the histogram and this is the dot plots. Concentric rings form around the population. More dense the population, the closer the rings are to each other. Density plot. Density plots simulate a three-dimensional display of events. Third parameter being the number of events. It is usually colored. Areas of higher density will have a different color than the other areas. Gating is isolation of a subset of cells on a plot. It is done electronically. Regions on these plots can be sequentially separated based on fluorescence intensity by creating a series of subset extractions termed gates. Software which allows selection of cells within a limited range of certain parameters to be analyzed can be rectilinear, amorphous, or numeric. Interpretation of graphs. An important tool for evaluating data is the dot plot. Instrument detects each cell as a point on an XY graph. This form of data presentation looks at two parameters of the sample at the same time. Forward scatter versus side scatter. To look at the distribution of the cells based upon size and granularity. Single versus side scatter. To visualize expression of fluorescence of cells. Two color fluorescence plot to differentiate between those cells that express only one of the particular fluorescent markers and those that express neither and those that express both. Used to discriminate dead cells from the live ones that are expressing the desired fluorescence. When to say an antigen is positive or negative. A sample has some cells, single positive for CD8. Along the x-axis and some single positives for CD4 along the y-axis. And the upper right quadrant of the plot, cells positive for both fluorescent markers CD4 and CD8. And the lower left quadrant, cells are negative for both the markers. How to differentiate dim and bright expression of an antigen? Dim, these are the cells, they present more towards the axis or the origin. The red, which is present towards the x-axis, and the pink, which are close to the zero on the y-axis. These are the dim. And bright, these are the cells that present away from the origin, that is from the zero. On x-axis, this is the green one, and on the y-axis, the yellow one. These are the bright cells. So these are some of the cellular features measurable by flow cytometer. That is morphology of the cell, biochemical features, functional attributes like DNA synthesis, mitosis, apoptosis, antigen expression, oxidative burst, and some miscellaneous like HLA typing and toxicology. Flow cytometry protocol. Specimen handling and sample preparation. The specimen can be single cell suspension or it can be peripheral blood, bone marrow material, lymph node, effusions, CSF fluid, urine, semen sample or any bacteria. Blood and bone marrow should be sent in EDTA or heparin. RBC lysis can be done using ammonium chloride. Tissue specimen, there should be mechanical dissociation followed by filtration. Reagents used are phosphate buffered saline, 0.5% formaldehyde. And typical density of the cells should be 10 raised to 5 to 10 raised to 7 cells per ml. Flow cytometer finds application under following headings. That is immunophenotyping, cell sorting, DNA content analysis, cell cycle analysis, apoptosis, and cell proliferation assays. In immunophenotyping, cell subsets are measured by labeling populations, specific proteins with a fluorescent tag on the cell surface. In clinical labs, immunophenotyping is useful in diagnosing hematopoietic neoplasms like lymphomas and leukemias, as well as for detection of antigens as therapeutic targets, minimal residual disease, platelet functions, and RBC disorders. Next is the flow cytometry also finds its application in cell sorting. The cell sorter is a specialized flow cytometer with the ability to physically isolate cells of interest into separate collection tubes. The sorter uses sophisticated
electronics and fluidics to identify and kick the cells of interest out of the fluidic stream into a test tube. DNA content analysis. It is a measurement of cellular DNA content by flow cytometry using fluorescent dyes such as propidium, iodide that intercalate into the DNA helical structure. The fluorescent signal is directly proportional to the amount of DNA in the nucleus and can identify gross gains or losses in the DNA. Then comes the cell cycle analysis. Flow cytometry can analyze replication states using fluorescent dyes to measure the four distinct phases of the cell cycle, along with determining cell cycle replication states. The assay can measure cell aneuploidy associated with chromosomal abnormalities. Apoptosis. The two distinct types of cell death, that is apoptosis and necrosis, can be distinguished by flow cytometry on the basis of differences in the morphology, biochemical and molecular changes occurring in the dying cell. Cell proliferation assays. The flow cytometer can measure proliferation by labeling resting cells with the cell membrane fluorescent dye, that is CFSC. When the cells are activated, they begin to proliferate and undergo mitosis. As the cells divide, half of the original dye is passed on to each daughter cell. By measuring the reduction of the fluorescent signal, researchers can calculate cellular activation and proliferation. To summarize, flow cytometers are designed for sensitive and quantitative fluorescence measurements of single cells. Clinical flow cytometry has been in existence for over 30 years. Cell surface, deep inside the cell to intracellular molecules and signaling pathways, and is poised to explore the genome. Prospects for combination of immunophenotyping with molecular phenotyping. Flow cytometer is multiparametric. Rapid analysis of large number of cells can be done. Information at a single cell level can be obtained. Detection of rare cell population, and it also allows physical isolation of cells of interest. These are some of the references. Thank you.
फिर भी अपने आप कर रहे हैं
नहीं वो आएंगे आपका भी बच्चा है क्या
हाँ
किसको बताना है?
वो ही दो बैठे थे ना।
हाँ
अंदर कनेक्शन
तो देखो ये सर्च फॉर हिम बट आई डोंट नो व्हेयर इज ही।
मेरा पेंडल भी वहीं पे लगा है।
मॅडम तुम्हाला काय वाटतं? माझं पण एक आहे ताजं पाच माझं शिवत मगासपासून मी खूप वेळ